Now, in the last 18 months, we have seen some astonishing events in the global economy during what is without doubt a fascinating period of economic history. Now, of course, fascinating is not necessarily the first word that springs to mind while the world's financial markets are seizing up, enormous uncertainty prevails, and in my case, one's company share price collapses dramatically in a matter of weeks. However traumatic the past year and a half may have been for companies, governments, and indeed citizens of countries, the financial crisis and the ensuing global recession have had a lasting impact on the shape of our world in ways which are only just becoming clear. Now, many of you will be aware or familiar with the so-called commodity supercycle, or the often cited belief that commodity prices would be stronger for longer, which prevailed from the late 2003 up to the impact of the financial crisis on mainstream economies in 2008. And perhaps just as many of you might well have looked at the tumbling commodity prices in late 2008 and early 2009 and concluded that the supercycle was dead and buried, fallen in battle during the financial crisis and subsequent recession, subdued demand from the West, and a decimated export industry in China. But the title of my address, I think, gives you some indication that I have a somewhat different perspective on this, and I'll talk in more detail later why I continue to believe that the factors that gave rise to the initial commodities boom are very much in force today, slowed only temporarily by the financial crisis. However, even today, some 18 months after that crisis, and after the depths of the credit crunch, liquidity remains constrained to all but the highest quality borrowers. Now, without the lifeblood that enables an industry to function, let alone to grow, slowdown in industrial production and consumer spending was inevitable and marked. And the deepest recession since the 1930s reached its nadir in March 2009. As a whole, entering the downturn with record levels of debt, around $180 billion in total, compared to an historical average of around about $30 billion. Mining share prices obviously came under extreme pressure, falling by up to 80% almost overnight, and customers preferred to deplete available stocks rather than buy from these companies, and therefore the whole proposition looked somewhat concerning. Now, I think as an important aside, it is instructive to share with you Xstrata's response. There are two ways in which an organization can respond to a crisis of this type and magnitude. Cut costs indiscriminately, batten down the hatches, and hope everything will wash over. Or see the downturn as an opportunity to substantially and sustainably improve the relative long-term competitive position of the organization, pairing it to benefit differentially in the upturn. Now, we obviously chose the latter. But we executed it in a unique way. We resisted the temptation to roll out a plan devised at head office. Rather, we asked our businesses to take action. We asked them to take every action they could to prepare us for what was looking like a prolonged recession. We didn't specify what was required. We simply set out Xstrata's situation, our view of the extent and nature of the crisis, and the requirement to conserve cash and take action without impairing our future prospects for growth and without impacting on safety and environmental performance. But perhaps the most important thing we did, which enabled the group to take this decisive and quick action, was to re-examine critically and ultimately reassert our convictions of the evolution of our industry and of our organization strategy. Increased demand from developing countries, developing markets, has resulted also in mines depleting even faster, while exploration for significant mines has not been as successful in the last decade as the one before. In fact, in copper, projections of supply made in 2007 of new copper expected to come on stream by 2020 have fallen by a cumulative amount of some 21 million tons by the end of 2009. So there's simply no confidence that this industry is able to supply into the long term. However, the key difference with the current secular change is its sheer scale. We are dealing with the urbanization and industrialization of over one third of the world's population, in China, in India, Brazil, and other developing countries, especially Southeast Asia. In fact, over 400 million people are expected to move to urban areas over the next 10 years. And as countries industrialize, the intensity with which they use metals and energy per capita increases. This dynamic of increased intensity of use is at the center of our belief in a secular change in demand. So in the aftermath of the world's largest financial crisis for almost a century, we looked at these convictions anew and found that despite this dramatic turn of events, our analysis showed that neither of these trends had been permanently arrested or reversed. So while Western economies were down and out and might take some time to recover, the driving forces of constrained supply and strong demand would at some point reassert themselves. In fact, one of the most significant impacts of the recent downturn of the mining industry has been the extent to which it has exacerbated the supply constraints that already existed. On the demand side, the global slowdown led to a period of unprecedented destocking of commodities, as I mentioned earlier. Even at the nadir of the crisis, commodity prices did not test their historical lows. Very weak demand from the OECD economies was partially offset by ongoing demand from China, India, and Brazil, albeit at lower levels than in the previous years. The downturn also underlined China's position as the dominant global user of commodities, with China accounting for over 100% of the growth in consumption in 2009. Obviously, the rest of the world's consumption declined. So what can we expect in the short term? I guess my view of the global economy in the short term is influenced by something which we developed as an early warning system, which tracks a number of leading indicators of economic conditions and end-use commodity user segments to assess the likely direction of the global economy and the key markets for our products over the next 3 to 9 months. Now, this analysis shows many encouraging signs that consumer and business confidence and manufacturing PMIs are increasing from the very depressed levels we saw last year in most major economies. Now, this slide shows that the US consumer remains key to global durable goods demand and global trade. Even in 2020, they will dominate this aspect of the world economy. Sustained growth is dependent on private domestic consumption and trade. Without this, all the infrastructure spend, which is currently fueling the Chinese economy, will dissipate in effect and value. Looking further out, however, the medium-term outlook for commodities remains very promising. The driving forces of industrialization and urbanization, which were barely impacted by the global downturn, seem unlikely to be significantly disrupted for some years to come. Now, these generational shifts in population and the infrastructure investment required to accommodate hundreds of millions of new city dwellers will require substantial new sources of key commodities such as iron ore, coal, copper, nickel, and zinc. And in time, demand from OECD will also return to more normalized levels, supported by the need in many countries to repair or replace aging infrastructure, leading to a period of synchronous demand for both the East and the West.